Well, after a few nice drinks, we will continue this subject. Information architecture in the Helix era. Yeah. And especially how we do it. Okay. Stand over here. That's a natural behavior is to walk around, not to stay over here. How we do it. It's our ideas about the Helix era of information architecture with the coming of the Helix architecture reference. About me. This is me, technology consultant at Macaw. Before I worked at Smartset and Mirabeau, and Macaw. That's an organization of about 250 people here in Amsterdam Schiphol, focused on Microsoft and Sitecore full service operations, interactive analytics, integration, and strategy. And that's some pictures from our last trip to Spain. Well, the goals that I want to achieve today are these. With Helix and Habitat, the Habitat example, that was food for thought. I think that's for most of you, the documents, I'm assuming that everybody have read the Helix documentation, that most of you have seen the Habitat example. It was, for us, it was food for thought. We analyzed Habitat. The implementation, we look how it maps to the ideas we have and the way we work. And we recognize that a good information architecture is key for a reusable framework based on Helix principles. Because that is something that we wanted to achieve, that we can create a kind of framework for our own. That we easily can reuse in as a base for the different projects that we are starting. And what we are doing is adapting all the good things and mix them with our own ideas. And yeah, we like to share those ideas today with you. It's not about code, it's about information architecture. So I'm I'm focusing a little bit about Helix, or what it, in three slides. Key idea about Helix is separating the different modules in several layers, the foundation, the feature, and the project layer. In the documentation, when we are looking to the parts of about the information architecture, it's about template types. And in the documentation, they are speaking about the interface template, the page type template, the data source template, the settings template, and the folder templates. This is a little copy of the website, so I guess most of you have read them and have an idea about what the purpose is of the different kinds of templates. And in different form, you see templates in this table, with also a summary in which layer the different kinds of templates should exist. Well, it's about templates today. It's about how do we set up an information architecture that we can use in our features, in our foundation. And I like to start with the way we work, and that's about the anatomy of a project. What do we mark as the root items of our projects? In Helix, there's one chapter about configuration and settings, and Helix says we differentiate configuration from settings in that settings are aimed at the user roles and configuration is aimed at the developer or IT system administrator roles. So there is a kind of settings that should be managed by editors and by administrators. And they state in the document that it's something that you have to think about. So we need a structured setup for settings that apply to a certain scope, and we, in our ideas, we attach those settings, structures set up to the site or project structure. What we had several projects, and when we had a look at the projects, this is a kind of structure that we use most times. At the top level, you'll see a kind of project folder. And within the project folder, there we find two so-called repository folders. A repository folder, the first one, the central repository or content repository, that contains reusable content that can be used in the sites by referencing or by cloning it into the sites. The metadata repository is a repository that contains all kinds of information that's supporting to or the content editor or to the front end, like your dictionaries, for example, but also the lookup lists that you can use in your content templates, data templates. So, if you translate it to some text, our project structure is mostly about, we have a project folder, a tenant folder, contains project settings. It's about, more about that in the next sheets. We have a central repository, we have a metadata repository, we have our site folder, and there, under the site folder, we have our home and a local repository. So we recognize three types of folders: a project folder, repository folders, and site folders. A project, a tenant, that's one or multiple sites, can have project repositories, not necessary. And all the page templates that you use, and also all your data source templates, are scoped to a project. That's a start point. This is also something that Helix says. Your page templates, your data source templates are scoped on a project. Layouts are scoped on a project. Renderings are scoped on a project. So all the sites within the same project use the same HTML output for renderings, but can differ by theme. So yeah, by theming, you can apply a different style while using the same HTML structure. All right, so this is some conditions that we have to deal with. And from this on, we are starting to create templates that makes it able to create a project folder, a repository folder, and a site folder, and at the same time, that can hold settings. And this is the way how we are defining our modules, features, the feature that's in the foundation layer, the settings module. When we define templates, we always start with some templates that's called I feature name, I settings in this case. It inherits from standard template, but it's empty, it's no more. And then we have our several other templates, in this case, underscore settings project, settings repository, and settings sites. And those three all inherit from standard template as well, but do inherit from I settings also. So within content editor, it looks like that. I will later in this story, I will explain why we use the different fields, because there are several multiple interpretations about it, but that's about that later. With these data templates, we can make an implementation in our project. So in the project folder, within the templates folder, we can create a project data template, which is based on underscore settings project, setting settings project, repository underscore settings repository, and site is highlighted underscore settings site, which also means that these data templates inherit from iSettings as well. That's one of the key issues of the key elements in this story. So why when we state that we want to create settings on our project repository and site folders, then we need a way a way to add additional settings that are scoped to the project, the repository, or the site. So when we are creating feature scoped or project scoped settings, we create a custom data template that's inheriting from iSettings, and you add some fields that are needed to set to add settings to the project repository site. For example, if you have a feature that's about the cookie warnings, every site can have a different cookie warning message. That's not something that you define in some rendering. No, that's something that's globally scoped for the whole site. So this is the best place to store that information is in the settings of the site. It is at the same time, it should be authored by administrators. So the role of administrator. So that's, we can create an underscore settings site cookie message data template, and by adding this underscore settings site cookie message template to the standard template as well, to the site template as well within the project scope, we extend the fields on that site folder with all kinds of settings that are scoped to the site. Yeah? Well, what is in this beginning of the story, what is different with Helix? In Helix, interface templates are prefixed with an underscore to signify that they are not interface templates, and that they are interface templates and cannot be instantiated as items. We create one more level of abstraction. The feature or module interface template is always prefixed with an I and is empty. All fields or interface templates that can apply within the feature are predefined or prefixed with an underscore. And we use a naming convention. All templates inherit from standard templates. Feature has empty interface templates. I feature name or feature functions, feature data fields start with underscore, feature name field name or feature name function. And why do we do this? That's important. What's the reason behind it? We like to check if some data applies to some feature. And with one simple question, do you inherit from I feature name, I know if some kind of data template is implementing a special feature. And once we know that, we can ask, which functions, which fields do apply from that feature, do apply to that implementation within the project scope. Maybe later I'm going to make it a little bit more clear. When we're talking about projects, we also have been talking about pages and assets on content and media. And within our project, we have two definitions. We have been talking about pages, and we have talking about assets. in the coming of habitat, assets is not the best name anymore. So data sources on the island is also not a good name as well. So we're looking for an intermediate name. But what is the difference between those? Pages is everything that has layout, has a URL. And for example, can appear in search results. It's used with the experience editor. The other hand, assets data source have no layout, have no URL, never appears in search results, used as data source for renderings. And we create two simple base templates, iPage and iAssets. Well, let's implement another feature. We are creating the content feature. What is the content feature about? Every page has a title and can have an abstract and an image. Assets can have title and image. Titles mostly appear above the page as the first element, H1. Abstracts can be used in lists, SEO data, or graph information, navigation. Image can be used in lists, over graph navigation, etc. And so the title, the abstract, and the image are three key fields that apply to most of our project scoped data templates. These fields, title, abstract, and image, can be used for SEO, over graph navigation, etc. But can also be a fallback for a more specific implementation of a SEO feature, an open graph feature, a navigation feature, etc. So that's, and because they are a fallback, this content feature is not in the feature layer, it's in the foundation layer. The name feature is, and maybe content module was better in this case. So, what's iContent, or what's the content feature look like? It's containing an iContent, and underneath we have the templates, underscore content title, underscore content abstract, and underscore content image. Each of them containing just one single field. Why is that? Why don't you put all these fields, content title, content abstract, and content image, into iContent? We'll come back to that later. But we are getting the wall template. Each field is nearly, it's not that necessarily strictly true, but always true. But mostly each field has its own data template. But at the same time, there can be multiple fields within one such an underscore feature function template. So, this is a feature. And with this feature, we have content image. And content image is referencing to the media library. That brings it immediately to the challenge how to organize our media library for a multi-project, multi-site scenario. Because source is set in the feature foundation layer. And it cannot be overruled at project level. You cannot say in this project you have to start at that root folder. In another project, you have to start at that root folder. There's no way to break in and overrule the source layer. I tried. I read the complete source code of Sitecore, almost. There's, but maybe some smart ass someday is able to do it. But we didn't find any way to override the source for, in this case, the image field. So we have to think about a different approach for the structure, for the organization of the media library. And that's what you see on the right side. Within the media library, we create a documents folder, an images folder, a videos folder, and some icons folder or whatever you can call them. And within those folders, there we create subfolders for projects. And so the structure of the media library is as shown. And access in item selectors, so like in this case, the image fields, but also drop tree list text image. When we want to filter the information that our editors can see, can handle, can select, we do that based on security. So by security, we can say if you are a member of project one, then we use security to hide all the other practices. So when somebody starts by selecting an image with the image selector and the dialog is opening, he only sees those folders that he has access to. A little bit thinking more about images. If we are dealing with images, it's a little sidestep. If we're dealing with images in projects, then in a multi-site environment, then those images can appear in all kinds of projects. Of these projects, the image is displayed maybe in a different aspect ratio. And as most often is defined in the interaction design, that an image, when it appears on the home page, is in 4:3 aspect ratio, but of some other place is 4:2 or 8:4, not it's 2:1, 1:1, etc. So in our one on foundation level, we are extending the image request with aspect ratio width and aspect ratio height. And it's not width by height, no, it's aspect ratio width and aspect ratio height and then a width. Because with images like this, we say we want a 4:3, okay, we do a center crop 4:3 and scale it down to requested width of 200 pixels. So if it is an image, but when you do center cropping on images, and then you can get unexpected results. So maybe we added some extra functionality for our content editors, for our so-called media library managers, for cropping images. And I have a little movie for that. Is it working?
Yeah,
it's working. So a little, what we do over here of an image, we added some extra fields, and you see we have some 8:2 fields, and we want to crop the image. So initial, the ratio is set up 8:2, we can scale it to some part of the image in the ratio 8:2, which is 4:1. And when it's stored, then when the cropping, when we select this this ratio of this cropping area and we accept it, then you will see that in the field that the cropping parameters are set. So if in the front end, in a project, an image is requested in a certain ratio, the user, the editor, can exactly tell which part of the image should appear in that ratio. If there is no ratio set, then a center crop, and that's what you see when you start the image, and then the center crop is calculated, and that's the remaining part of the image that you get. But this was a little sidestep about images and media. So we created our content feature. So we can create our first page type template. We create the home page, and there we see we create a page type. It's something that's needed in URL, so we let it inherit from iPage, and we add the fields content title, content abstract, and content image. And this is what it looks like. Wow. No rocket science. Well, up to the next feature, the navigation feature. Menu and simple link list that bring me somewhere inside. So, when we have a website, we have the main menu, we have maybe a country navigation, we have some social link list, we have footer navigation, we have header navigation. There are all kind of little lists in our websites. So, in this one we see only text. In the link list, social media list, there we see some icons. So if we think about what is navigation like, which fields can appear in navigation, and this can be a definition of the navigation feature. It's something that has a title, it's something that has a link, it has to bring us somewhere, it has some behavior. In this case, the behavior is hide in navigation, but can maybe extended in some more advanced behavior. There can be an icon, and in some cases maybe there is an image. So this can be a first implementation of our navigation feature. Well, and with the navigation feature, we can, for example, create navigation items. I will focus, for example, on the country navigation over there. In the country navigation, we see all kinds of countries collected in continents, where the continent is not clickable, but the country is well, and it brings us to another country site. So the implementation of the country navigation can be like this. We create in our project, we create our project templates. This, in this case, is a country navigation. We create a country navigation folder, which inherits from iAsset, because it does not have an URL. Navigation title and navigation behavior. No icon, no image. Oh, and link. I forgot about link, I'm sorry. Oh no, not in this case. I'm right. But no link, because we saw that the folder and the continents don't have any link. So we don't have to confuse the editor with a field that's not necessary. And on the same hand, we can definitely define the country navigation item. iAsset, navigation title, navigation behavior, and navigation link. And with these data templates, projects specific project scope data templates based on our feature definition interface templates, we can create a navigation structure somewhere in the metadata repository for country navigation, because that's going to be used on all country sites in this case. Well, to display this somehow, we need a rendering. And the rendering needs a data source. But we are thinking wider than only the country navigation. We're thinking about navigation as a feature. So within the navigation feature, we have a second feature. And in this call, a navigation component. And again, we define an iNavigation component. That's the main interface. Then we have some fields, component title, component root folder, depth, and include root. And with this navigation component, we can do two kinds of implementations. We can make a rendering that uses some data source item which contain these fields. So we have some title that should be appear above our, in this case, country navigation menu. Select your country. We have a root folder where we have the star. We have a recurring depth of navigation items that should be collected, in this case 3, and we want the root folder in the navigation as well. But there's also a different, so we can add the rendering to our within the experience editor or somewhere else, you can add the rendering and select the data source item that contains these values. But there's a second way. We can also implement this as site settings. We create an underscore settings site country navigation template, site settings template. It contains this section, and within there we add the two fields, country navigation title and country navigation root folder. And then we have to think about the code implementation a little bit. So the code implementation that's behind this feature. Well, when we are coding our renderings, we do that on the project level. Next slide. This is according to Helix, and so hereafter. We say that in the project scope, we define our controller renderings for collecting parameters, title, root, etc., especially for the settings variant. And then we use the feature layer to get the items based on those parameters and do some additional business logic. In the project rendering, there is the output created. An optional default output can be in the feature layer, but the output is created, in our opinion, in the project layer. Is this according to Helix? No. Helix, as in the example implementation of habitats, creates markup in the feature layer. And we think that HTML does not belong to the feature layer, but belongs to the project layer, except maybe for some default presentation. Why? Because this same markup is reusable for all sites within the project. Theming can be used for alternative styling, but a different project has mostly a complete different markup. So that's for example, a navigation. So that's the reason why we think that the markup of does not belong to the feature, but does belong in the project layer. The feature layer is there only for creating data and doing the business logic. So we have a different opinion on the Helix architecture. Food for discussion later. So, I said before, we created the iNavigation feature and the navigation feature, and we had all those different fields, and with the underscore, every field has an own template. Now, why was that? Because we want to have the flexibility to, for example, extend our page type template with navigation title and navigation behavior. Because from then on, the navigation component is also able to start at the home page and do a recurring lookup for all items that implement the iNavigation data template. And the base template of this feature. Yeah, do you implement iNavigation? Yes, I do. Okay, then we're going on. Just this single question: do you implement iNavigation? And yes, in that case, come into my collection of navigation items. So by adding these two fields to the page type in this case. All our page items in the tree are able to be appear in some menu using the navigation component data source as start. You can do it without any data source as well, because you define this rendering on the project layer. And maybe in that scope, you know already that the depth has to be 2, 3, 4 or whatever, and that the home item should be the start point. And what's so the project implementation is this, and the role for the navigation feature is to do business logic. because a navigation, if we add navigation to our page type, page, we didn't add the navigation link. If page, then navigation link is the URL of the page. That's the business logic that the feature has to do. And also, if iPage and navigation title is empty, use content title. What I said in the beginning, we can use content title as a fallback for other features. Because editors are lazy, they fill in the title and they forget about all the rest. But in the case the title that appears in the menu is still on, they always have the ability to add a special navigation title. So that's the role of the navigation feature. In our opinion. Sort of template sections. Ordering are crap. Maybe you nailed this already. When I add these, if we have all those separate data templates and we add them to the homepage template in the project, then it's very difficult to keep track on the sort order of the sections. There's some solution. You can think about this, that you create some user interaction design of the content editor with where the main properties is 0 to 99, and that you use the sort order on template section items to add appropriate numbers, and then you keep your fingers crossed if everything is working well. But we find a little solution for that. There is always a pipeline, and also in this case, there is some cat content editor fields pipeline. In this pipeline, retrieves the fields for the content editor and does a lot of sorting based on Sitecore's own rules. But at the end of that pipeline, a new process can be inserted, which checked if an I sort sections on base template or a template is inherited, gets the order of the base templates of the current template, collects the reverse order of the section of the base template, and let the sections bubble up. And to show you that, it's much easier to film it once. Over here you see that the navigation properties were above the content properties, and we create a little feature that's called section order. This has some template that's completely empty. It's just for checking. And when we go back to the implementation, this case standard values, you see that the order of the sections is according to the base template order, which makes it easier to sort all those sections. Some ideas to take away. Well, we're talking about features. But what is exactly the granularity of features that we want to have? How small or big is a feature? Habitat has the feature news. And within the feature news, there are these templates, interface templates, with the fields news title, news summary, news date, news image, and news body. But in the whole Habitat project, there's also something that has base template underscore has content, which implements title and abstract as well. So why are we introducing a new title field again? Why are we introducing a new summary slash abstract field again? Assume a new feature event, which according to this structure has event title, event summary, event date. Have we re-implement all these fields again? Do we create the feature has also renderings for news list and news teaser? Do we have to create renderings for event list and event teasers as well? And then we go to vacancies, and then we go to products, and then we go to, are we re-implementing the same logic time over time? And besides, it means that creating a combined list of news and events is only possible through the search feature or something, And logic for tiers is maybe written twice. But the start and end dates that we implement in the event feature can be reused in other page or assets as well. For example, a training or course. So the event feature contains fields that can be reused in other features as well. So what we think is that there should be more granularity in the features. Event has schedule properties, start and end dates. Content, if you use, has publication properties, publication data, order. Offices and departments have address properties. Offices, departments, and persons have contact properties, phone, fax, email, websites, social links, etc. And all these properties are used to assemble the page templates and assets. We use those properties parts, schedule, publication, address, for us, that are the features. And I will give you an idea what that is look like, and then using the address and the contact properties. On the left side, we see the address feature. It has this base template I address with an underscore address location. And over here, you see that's not necessary that there only that there is only just one field within such an underscore interface template. It can be multiple. There is an address location and an address location country, and we have a mailing address, which is and mailing address is same as the location address, and otherwise if we have an address mailing and address mailing country. And on the right side we see the contact feature with iContact, and we have something that's called phone numbers, fax numbers, email addresses, social accounts. And with these two features and the content feature as well, we can implement an office asset. And there's some data source that's containing office data. It has a title, it has an abstract, it has an image. It has the address location. The office has a mailing address. The office has a map where you can select a geocode. There are the phone numbers, the fax, or whatever. So we select the fields that are applicable to the office. And this is then what it's gonna look like. We created a custom field. This is not a name lookup value list, but a lookup name value list. The left hand, you see some properties, first address, second address, third, postcode, city. There is a space from some improvement, thank you. So this is what the address is like. This is the location, the country of the address. And over here is the mailing address and the contact properties. This do look the same. So we assembled an asset based on our feature. This office asset implement three features: the content feature, the address feature, for the geo feature, and the contact feature. And with that, we can create a rendering for that, the project scope. But at the same time, we can use the custom experience editor buttons, and then we can easily add those properties again. And the fun part of this is by create an edit address properties custom experience button, we can add all the fields, but in the project, in the it's filtering all the only those it is showing only those fields that are implemented in the asset or page template. So we think that a more granularity on the feature level and the module level is necessary to create a set of features that's easier reusable over different projects. Maybe in the same instance, side instance, a multi-tenant situation, but also over projects for different customers. Well, then a last part is, I can talk about this for one more hour because I left out a lot of things. This is a not yet implemented situation. how to deal with metadata in a multi-tenant environment. When we looked at this one, the address as a Lucas named value list, then you see over here that we have some drop-down lists that you can set the first address and postcode, city and state. But say that we're in the same Sitecore instance, we have the new project, and the new project, this is how it's configured. That you see this list is configured because we have some items, first address, and second, third, fourth, postcode, the city state, and we have an address location that's using those items for as a data source. But this is done on feature level. And in a multi-project, multi-tenant situation, that's not something that we want. Because what if, in a new project, completely targeted on the Netherlands, the list should contain street, house number addition, postcode, and city. For item selectors, we already had a sort of a solution using security and access rights. But that could be implemented on this level as well, but a little bit hard. Can we, however, override the source on feature level? Can we the source set of feature level? Can this be overridden in project? And we think yes, because there is the get lookup source items pipeline. And maybe for people who remember Habitat, Habitat has the local data sources implementation, where you can set local data sources. The same sort of implementation can be used for this. We get some a project, my project address source value item. And in the my project address source value item, there's literally a stored data source is. And by adding a pipeline processor in this get lookup source items pipeline at the beginning, and then we can override the source for all these kinds of fields. It's exactly the fields that mostly contain these kinds of drop-down lists. So, this is a brief how we do it. Information architecture in the new Helix era. A summary. We adapt most of the Helix architecture, all things that I did not talk about, and the thing that's in the foundation where we are investigating this and we use it the best from it and from Habitat. We use a more granular approach of our feature definitions. We like to delegate presentation to the project layer, but we are always evaluating and improving. Thank you.
Questions?
I forgot to tell at the beginning, I have two hearing aids.
Yes.
So speak loud and clear.
Yeah, I have
a second lens over here.
I wanted to ask you, you have a navigation component. Yeah. And in navigation component, you, for example, specify route in item. Why you don't use custom template properties for your rendering?
In navigation component?
Parameter template.
It's over here. This one, the navigation component.
Yes.
It's a title, it's a root folder, a depth, and an include root.
Yes, for example, a root folder is it a field in an item, and you specify it in an item, but you can also use it on the rendering custom properties.
Yeah, that's also possible.
Yeah, this but is why you decided to do like this?
If we have a navigation rendering implementation and it needs a data source item that tells it where to start, you can select it over here. If for example, but some of but I over here I stated that there are also already two different ways of implementing and navigation rendering by using a data source, by using the site settings. But over here in this one, when we have been talking about the main navigation, you can delegate all those information into the rendering itself, because the rendering knows where to start, home item, find the home item within the site. It knows that the route item should be included. It knows that it has that the depth should be a lot.
So for this case, you use custom properties. For other cases, if it's site specific or something specific, you use the items. Kind of, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I should say yeah.
But you don't need the rendering parameters, right?
No, you don't. Yes, indeed.
More?
Are they ready? No, okay.
I don't know.
Any other questions? This is, how do you say that? This is how we do it. As we like to share it with you, maybe there are some interesting ideas in it, maybe not. Maybe you come back to me now and later there, over there with a beer and say, what are you doing? Yeah. So, as I said at the end, we also always evaluating and improving. This is our vision, our of information architecture.
Getting the best from all the different, also looking at Ignition, looking at Helix, Habitat, and take the best from it and combine.
Sorry, I have a question. Do you use any kind of object mapping or code generation?
For our code?
Well, to map to the template you define.
You use class or? Yeah.
So how do you?
We use the habitat approach with the template.
Custom models.
Yeah, but you can also use any ORM in this case as well.
Yeah, and how do you deal then between the dependencies? Features and layers.
Dependency between the feature and the foundation layer? Or the dependency
in
the.
Yeah, because Helix also says you should not have dependencies between features on the same level, like in foundation or in the feature level, between the modules.
All our dependencies are going up to the foundation, so we don't have no horizontal dependencies.
But if I remember correctly, for example, for navigation, you have a fallback to the content type.
Yeah, the content feature was in the, because it's the base of everything, was in the foundation layer.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, that's the reason. Somewhere on Slack, I saw some discussion that's, in that case, more and more features were moving to the strong foundation layer, and that foundation layer was going to be like this big, while the feature layer was going to be like this or something, and the project was, there was no project here because time was up.
Did you guys run into problems with setting up all this many projects? With all the references, how did you set up the solution? Did you, for each feature, you had a different project, or a lot like in Habitat?
The question is, how do we start our projects?
No. If you have a separate web project and serialization stuff for each feature,
mm-hmm.
Do you guys have that?
No, we don't. Okay. We're looking into that. Right now, but and
do you guys use Unicorn TDS or?
It's a TDS right now.
Okay.
But we don't follow the Habitat example.
Okay. Well, basically, we had this before Helix was.
Yeah.
So basically, we're evaluating now how to move forward in it.
So a feature is just a folder, in fact.
So basically, we had the Helix approach more or less before Helix was.
Exactly. Yeah. What do you think about a beer?
Good question.